What's up, Pinedale kids? I am so excited that you have joined us today for Church at Home. We've got a great service plan for you, and I get to tell you one of my favorite Bible stories out of the Old Testament. But before we get started, I need you to do a few things. First, go find your Bible, open up to 1 Kings chapter 18. That's where our Bible story is coming from today. Be sure to grab a highlighter or a pencil or something you can use to take notes in your Bible. I also want you to borrow your mom or dad's phone, then call three people and invite them to watch Church at Home at the same time you're doing it. It could be a friend, a neighbor, a family member. One last thing, I want you to grab a snack out of your cabinet, maybe a drink out of the refrigerator. You're gonna have that during our lesson time. I'm gonna give you 5 minutes, and those 5 minutes start now.
Hey kids, welcome to Church at Home. Today, I want to give you a hug. An air hug. Seriously though, I can't wait till I can give you a real big hug. And also can't wait for us to get into our praise and worship. So, let's stand up on our feet and let's get started.
Restore me, forever save my life.
Today, we're going to once again set up Sean's lesson a little bit, and later when he does his lesson, he's going to talk about Elijah and the prophets of Baal. And Elijah was just one prophet, and the prophets of Baal were many, many prophets, hundreds of them. And this was a contest between Elijah, one prophet, and many, many prophets for an idol, for a fake god. And one of the points of the story is the fact that our God, the God of Elijah, is a living God. He's a real God who actually hears and answers our prayers. Well, that sounds really familiar, doesn't it? And the prophets of Baal were standing for a god, a fake god, a god made of stone or wood, actually made with human hands. And so I'm thankful that we pray to a God who's real, who hears and answers our prayers. And it's not about which God is most popular, because obviously one person standing for the true God and hundreds of prophets standing for a fake God, well, you'll find out later who actually answered, but you probably already know. So today I want to focus our prayer time on thanking God for hearing and answering our prayers, for being a living God. We just celebrated Easter and remembered that Jesus rose from the dead. He's still alive. He is living, and he's hearing our prayers, and he's answering them every day. And he knows our situation. He's a personal God. He's not just some God you stick on a shelf or make out of stone or wood. And just like in the story, Elijah being one and the prophets of Baal being many, many prophets, sometimes we have to stand alone. Sometimes we have to stand by ourselves for the truth. And it doesn't really matter how many people stand with us as long as we stand for the truth. So, in addition to thanking God for hearing and answering our prayers, I want to also ask God to help us to have courage when we have to stand up on our own for his truth, that he will give us the spirit that we need to fight for his truth and to stand for his truth, no matter how many people stand with us. So, as always, you can also pray about anything else that you want. So let's take a few moments, thank God for hearing and answering our prayers and giving us the courage to stand for what's right, even if we have to stand alone. I'll give you a moment to pray, and then I'll close this out. Dear God, I am so thankful that you are a living God who hears and answers our prayers. You know what's going on in our lives, and you care about it. You care about what's going on with us. Whatever's important to us is also important to you, and we're so thankful for that. We thank you for being a part of our lives. And I also want to just pray that you would give us courage, because there are times when we have to stand for something all by ourselves, and we also know that we're not by ourselves because you are with us. Thank you for giving us the courage that we need, and I pray that you would continue to do that. Be with every other request. Lord, you know each and every request that's going up all over our area, maybe all over the country, as we all pray together. God, we love you so much. We thank you for Jesus. It's in his name we pray, and all God's kids said, amen.
Wow, you guys did a great job during worship today. I love watching you guys. I love watching kids worship. And then Denise's prayer time. Man, that is the perfect lead-in for our lesson today. But before we get to the lesson, let's give you this week's announcement. I know normally we do this at the end, but we need to do it right now because I have a secret that I don't want your moms to hear, okay? Now, let me give you what happens first. Today is the last day for the family photo hunt. So here's our list of photos that you can submit to us. You can get this list right here by going to pinedale.church/kids. At the very bottom, it's got a little bar there that says Family Photo Hunt. You click on that, you can get the list. You can also read instructions on how to get those photos to us. Please do not text them to us or email them to us. Upload them to the website, okay? That's the best way to get them to us. Next announcement. This Wednesday, what are we gonna be doing? But you know, we started off calling it Wednesday Night Live, and we're still calling it that, but we need a new name because we're not really live. We're recording it and then posting it, and it goes live at 7 o'clock on Wednesday nights. But we're doing lots of different things with you guys. We've played games, we've told jokes, we've adventured out and visited some families. But we need a name to kind of match up with what we're doing. So if you have a suggestion, send it to us. For this Wednesday night, we're doing something super unique. We're going to do a guided painting class. What we're going to be doing is we're going to be painting things like this right here. Aren't these awesome? These are samples for you guys to be doing on Wednesday night. We have some art teachers that are going to be teaching a class for us and are going to walk us through painting these. And myself, and Showers, and Michelle, and I'm not sure who all is helping out, but we're going to be kind of guinea pigs and we're going to be doing it at the same time. Now, you're going to need supplies. In fact, you're going to need all of these supplies right here. But don't go out and buy them. We've already bought them and we have them at the church ready for you to come pick up. You can't pick them up until Monday night. But Monday night, we'll send you a text and let you know this. All you have to do is just pull up to the gym. We've got bags. You just grab a bag, get back in your car, and leave. But you're gonna need all of these supplies. We're giving you the board, the brushes, the paint, the Q-tips, everything that you need except for paper towels and water, which you got at home. Now, here's what's really exciting. This painting is actually going to be a Mother's Day gift that you can give to your mom next Sunday. So let's keep that a secret, okay? In addition to this board, we're also giving you an envelope and a card. You can sign the card, put it in the envelope, and the envelope gets taped to the back of this. Isn't that awesome? I'm super excited. But what makes me even more excited is today's lesson.
The Bible. It's 66 books of history, stories, letters, and poetry that fit together to form God's one big story. The epic adventure of how he created us and loves us so much that he made a way to rescue us. As we travel through the Bible, from Genesis to Revelation, we discover people who met God and found their lives changed forever. And now for an amazing story.
I want to tell you about a time when I was in high school. There was this kid who was a big bully and he liked to pick on me. And one time he was sitting behind me in class and he kept shaking his chair with his foot. And I was getting so annoyed, so I turned around and I'm like, cut it out! He didn't stop. So I had to tell him several times. And finally, this one time I turned around and I yelled at him. I raised my voice and I'm like, cut it out! Well, that got the attention of the teacher. And so she came and got onto both of us. Well, when the teacher turned around to go back to the front of the class, this kid pulled out his pencil. No, this is a pen, but he took out this pencil and he stabbed it in my back and he scraped it down the middle of my back. Oh, it hurt so bad. I screamed out, ow! Well, the teacher heard it and she came over and I didn't say anything to the teacher. After school, my mom picked me up, and as we were driving down the road, I lifted up my shirt and I was like, hey mom, is there a mark on my back? And she looks over and sees this scrape down the middle of my back, and she comes screeching to a halt, and she's like, what happened to you? I told her, and she turned that truck around and took me back to the school. Well, what ended up happening was the bully got kicked out of school for a few days. When he came back to school, he had to call my mom for some reason and apologize for what had happened. Well, my mom, who is a very godly woman, came all the way up to the school and she gave the kid a card. And she had written some kind of words of encouragement to him, or maybe even a prayer. I'm not sure. What I am sure of is that later that day, when we were in gym class, this bully got several of his friends to pay me a visit. I'm shooting basketball and I go to get a rebound, and when I turn around, 8 boys circle around me. And this bully emerges and he takes this card and he throws it at me and he says, I had to call your mom and apologize, and this is what she did, and this is the garbage she wrote in the card. And I just stood there knowing that there's a good chance he's gonna start a fight with me. So I stepped up to him, I got nose to nose with him, and I said, oh, I'm sorry. What can I say? I actually have a mom that loves me. Well, bam! He punches me in the face, and I'm like falling back, and the coach is coming over, and the PE teacher, and they're breaking it all up. Well, he ended up getting kicked out of school. When there are 8 bullies that circle around you, can we all agree that the odds are not in your favor? Chances are you're going to lose. But what if the odds were 850 bullies against one? Chances are you're going to lose. But that's exactly what the odds were in today's story. And I'm so excited to tell you this story. It comes from 1 Kings chapter 18. It has been an exciting journey so far. We've been traveling through the Bible from start to finish, and we're discovering how the Bible is not just a collection of tiny little stories, but rather it's one big story about how God is sending us a Redeemer, someone to save us from the penalty of our sins. And all those tiny little stories are intertwined together. They're all connected. Last week, we learned about two guys with similar names. We had Rehoboam and Jeroboam. I had a guy that texted me a cool way of remembering who each of them were. Rehoboam was the chosen king. He was related to King David. And if you remember, God promised that ultimately he's going to give us a king that will save the whole entire world. And that king will come from the line of David. So the way we'll remember Rehoboam is this. His name starts with an R, and so does the word royal. Rehoboam was the royal king. Jeroboam was a jerk. And both of those words start with the letter J. Jeroboam is the one who split the nation of Israel, God's chosen people. He took 10 of the tribes and kept the name Israel, and they were also the northern tribes. The other two tribes, or the southern two, took on the name Judah. Last week, we also learned that the northern kingdom, again called Israel, had nothing but bad kings. Judah, or the southern kingdom, did have some good kings that we'll talk about a little bit later. Even though Israel had turned their backs on God, God never turned his back on them. He sent special messengers to point the Israelites back to God. These messengers are called prophets. Before we dive into today's story, I want you to watch a short video to give you a recap of what we've learned so far.
In the beginning, God created the universe and a planet called Earth. Humans were formed in God's image to continue God's work. But soon, humans decided we want to live our way, not God's. Selfishness and violence filled the world. So God started over with just one family. And God made a covenant with a man named Abraham. The land around you is now yours. Your family will be my blessing to the entire world. In just a few generations, they grew into a large nation named Israel. The Egyptians became fearful and forced the Israelites to be their slaves. Through a humble leader named Moses, God led the Israelites in a great exodus back toward their promised land. Along the journey, God gave laws and commands to help the Israelites follow God's ways. Finally, after 40 years of struggle and complaining in the desert, the Israelites arrived back home in the promised land. In victory, the people worshiped God, but soon after, they turned from God and lived their own rebellious ways. This became a pattern from generation to generation. Now living back in their promised land, Israel continually struggled to follow God's ways. So Saul became Israel's first king. But he led the country poorly and turned his back on God. So God chose a courageous young man named David to be king. God blessed Israel greatly under David's leadership. David passed on his throne to his son, Solomon, who was full of God's wisdom. Solomon built a magnificent temple, but as the years passed, Solomon strayed from God, and the country was torn apart in civil war. So God sent prophets as messengers to challenge the Israelites to return to God's better ways, but they wouldn't listen.
So we heard a lot of bad news in the last story. I can't believe that out of all the kings of Israel, not one of them chose to follow God. But it kind of makes sense because remember, God's chosen king was living in Judah. Even though the people living in Israel were worshiping false gods, our God, the one true God, still loved them and he kept trying to get the people to follow him. To do that, he sent special messengers called prophets. And one of the most famous prophets was a guy by the name of Elijah. Elijah lived during the reign of King Ahab. King Ahab was the worst of the worst kings of Israel. King Ahab married a daughter of another king, and her name was Jezebel. And she was put in charge of all the religions of Israel. One of the things that she did was she got all of God's prophets together and she murdered all of them. Well, all of them except for one, Elijah. And one day, Elijah came to King Ahab and told him there would be a famine over all the land because of Israel's sin. Elijah told King Ahab it would never rain again until Elijah said it would. Ahab blamed Elijah for the famine and tried to kill him. Elijah challenged Ahab to a contest to see whose God was real, the God of Israel or Ahab's God, Baal. Ahab accepted the challenge and they called all the people of Israel to come to Mount Carmel. Mount Carmel, that sounds delicious. Let's take a break. Do you remember at the start of Church at Home, I told you to grab a snack? Well, now it's time for you to eat your snack. I've got mine. It is a chocolate molten lava cake. It is my favorite dessert.
Me too.
Is it? So here's what we got. It's made up of chocolate cake, and then it's got this fudge on the inside that's all melted. And then you take ice cream and you put ice cream on top of it. So we're gonna scoop out the ice cream.
And then I gotta add some more ice cream on there.
Uh-huh. So put the ice cream. And then what?
You put chocolate fudge on it.
Or no, this is just chocolate syrup.
But you hold on to it
because there's still some inside there, and you're gonna use some of the cake to dip in there and get it out. And then this here is melted caramel.
Not caramel.
Caramel. That's right. Every time we tell this story about Elijah and the prophets of Baal, it makes me think of this dessert because they had their battle on top of Mount Carmel, not Mount Caramel. Alright? So, you want some?
Yeah.
Let's dig in. You guys just kind of eat your own dessert, well, or a snack. I guess you got a snack. Mmm. Oh, yeah. But you know, the trick is, you gotta get a little bit of each part. So, you see how I got cake, ice cream, fudge, chocolate, and there's the caramel. Mmm, you're just gonna go wrong with this. Mm-hmm. Now, we're gonna have our own little battle here because this is our Mount Carmel. See how it's kind of coming down? Oh, right there. Wait, where is it? Right there. Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. Mark and I share this dessert and we always fight over it. Like scrape it off each other's forks. You want some? She does, but she doesn't want to come on camera to eat it. So we're not going to let her have any. Alright. You keep eating your dessert or your snack while we eat ours. But let me get back to the story. Ooh, that was a yummy snack. Let's get back to our story. There's two sides. Elijah, God's man, versus the priest of Baal and this other fake god. Together, they had 850 men. Here was the challenge. Both Elijah and the priest of Baal, which again had 850 men, they're both going to build an altar made out of stones, and they're going to sacrifice a bull, place it on top of the altar. They would then call on their gods to send fire down on the altar. Whichever one answered, that was the only one true God. Now, the prophets of Baal loved this challenge because Baal was often referred to as the god of weather. He's often depicted as this god holding a lightning bolt. So let's check out what it says. In 1 Kings 18, we read that the priest of Baal started first. They started dancing around and praying to Baal. Verse 26 says, they did this from morning till noon. They shouted, but there was no response. I would underline those words right there. It's in verse 26. There was no response. No idol or fake god can ever answer you. They aren't real. I love the Bible. It's my favorite book, and I love reading it. It is so exciting to read. But some people think the Bible is boring, and what do I tell you? If you think the Bible is boring, you're not reading it right. This is hilarious. In 1 Kings 18, verse 27, I want you to look at what it says here. At noon, Elijah began to taunt them. He says, "Shout louder. Surely he is a god. Perhaps he's deep in thought, or busy, or traveling. Maybe he's sleeping, or must be awakened." Stop right there. Now, you want to know something really funny? Elijah is making fun of these guys. And those words right there where it says in verse 27, or he may be busy, maybe your God is busy. Do you want to know what that means? A literal translation or an exact translation of that phrase means
maybe your God is in the bathroom. Yeah, so your God's over there in the bathroom. Yeah, he hasn't brought down fire yet because he's in the bathroom. And yeah, you've been praying for 3 hours. That's nothing. My dad stays in the bathroom for a long time. So he's making fun of them. And then in verse 28, it says this. So they shouted louder and slashed themselves with swords and spears until their blood flowed. Verse 29, midday passed, and they continued their frantic prophesying until the evening. Underline this last sentence. But there was no response. No one answered. No one paid attention. No, 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 no one. No one paid attention. No one gave an answer. This is important to see. They had 850 priests. They shouted and made a lot of noise, but there was no answer. You know, in your life, you're going to have moments where you have to stand up for God. And when you do, oftentimes, people are going to push back and tell you that you're wrong, or that God isn't real, or maybe what you believe is old-fashioned. Chances are you're going to be outnumbered. Elijah was, but that doesn't matter. Truth is not based on how many people believe something or how many people don't believe it. Truth is based on, is it true? From morning till noon, and then from noon until evening, the people who worship Baal cried and prayed and slashed themselves, and they danced around trying to get Baal to bring down fire, but it never happened. It now became time for Elijah's turn. But watch what he does. Then Elijah said to all the people, this is in verse 30, he says, come here to me. So they came to him, and he repaired the altar of the Lord. Elijah took 12 stones. Pause for a second. You know why he used 12 stones? To represent the 12 tribes of Israel. Remember how Jacob had the 11 brothers, so there was 12 of them all together, and they moved to Egypt, and then became slaves there, but then God raised up Moses to bring them out of Egypt. They formed the nation of Israel, and now Israel is now split into two groups, Northern Kingdom and the Southern Kingdom. Northern Kingdom is Israel, the Southern Kingdom is Judah. The people in Judah did a much better job of following God, but God still pursued the people of Israel. So here's what Elijah does. Elijah rebuilds the altar with 12 stones. With these 12, after he put the 12 stones there, in verse 32, it says that he then dug a trench. A trench is kind of like a ditch, like a hole, all the way around the whole entire altar. He arranged wood, then he cut the bull into pieces and laid it on top of the altar. Then he does something that only God would do. And I realize that Elijah's not God, but he's getting his instructions from God. And I love this. He then says, I want you to fill 4 large jars with water. I often tell you guys that when you're reading the Bible, don't read it with second faith. And what do I mean by that is, you don't just read the words and just in a second you automatically believe it and accept it. Pause and put yourself in this situation and really think through this. Fill 4 large jars of water. It hasn't rained here in years. Now, if it doesn't rain, what happens to the streams and the rivers and the creeks and the ponds? Yeah, they dry up. So where did they get their water? And by the way, where are they? They're on top of Mount Carmel. Is there water on top of a mountain? No. So when he says, I want you to fill these 4 jars with water, I want you to just pause for a minute and immerse yourself into this story. They have to go find the water. They have to go down the mountain to find the water. They got 4 large jars of water, and these jars could hold up to between 60 and 80 gallons of water. Well, that's not something that one person can carry. So you got guys that are carrying tons. I mean, these guys are—they have multiple guys that are carrying these jars. They go down the hill. They have to scrounge up some water. Hey, let me have that bottle of Dasani. I'm gonna pour it in here. Let me have that bottle of water. I'm gonna pour it. Let me go to the water fountain. Oh, it's dried up. They fill up the jars. They come back up the mountain. They pour the water on top of a bowl. It saturates the wood. It pours down the rocks. It starts to go in the ditch. And then Elijah says, go do it again. Wait, so we gotta go down the mountain again and find more water and a bunch of us have to carry it up there? Okay, so they do it. So they start off with four jars and then they did another four jars. And then he says, do it again. They go get another four jars. So they've got 12 stones. They've got 12 jars of water. Why that? I don't know. But what I do know is that there was so much water on there that the bull is soaking wet. The wood is soaking wet. The water is drenched over. The water is filling up this trench here and it's staying in there. So now the dirt's all wet. Now, the thing I want you to see on this is the water is their most precious commodity at that moment. Everybody was short on water. They were hurting for it. Without water, you can't grow crops. Without water, you can't feed your cattle, your animals, your flocks. And so that's really bad news for them. And so he takes their most precious commodity and he pours it out on the ground. I think there's a significance here that sometimes what God wants from us is for us to give him what we think is most important in our life. To hand it over to him and let him use it. That's called a sacrifice. So what happens? Elijah then says this prayer. O Lord, God of Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, let it be known today that you are God in Israel. In verse 38, as soon as Elijah said amen, fire from heaven fell and burned up the sacrifice, the wood, the stones, and the soil, and it licked up the water in the trench. When all the people saw this, they fell down and they cried, "The Lord, He is God!" Then Elijah commanded them, "Seize the prophets of Baal. Don't let them get away." They captured those 850 men. They took them down the mountain and they killed them. They got rid of the thing that was going to separate people from following God. Now you would think after this great victory that Elijah would be like, yeah, this is awesome. Yes, the people are finally gonna turn back to God. But you know what? They didn't. They did for a moment, but King Ahab didn't. I don't understand that because King Ahab is sitting there and he's watching this. For 12 hours, he watched the prophets of Baal cut themselves, dance around and pray and go, hey, come on, Baal, bring down fire. And nothing happens. And then he watches Elijah do it. And Elijah spends several hours making this happen, rebuilding the altar, cutting the bowl up into pieces, sending them to get jars full of water three times, pouring water on there, and the very first time he prayed, fire comes down. King Ahab's mad at him though. King Ahab goes home, and from Mount Carmel to the palace is about 16 miles. So he's in a chariot, and he's riding along. Now there's a really cool part of the story. We're not gonna really unpack what happens, but Elijah takes his robe and he ties it up and he tucks it into his belt and he takes off running and he actually passes King Ahab while he's running. He's in a chariot, he's running, zoom, gets ahead of him. When King Ahab gets home, he tells his wife Jezebel, and Jezebel sends a message to Elijah saying, I will kill you this day because of what you've done. Elijah then flees. He runs away. He actually goes to Judah where he can be safe. Because remember, the people up in Israel aren't gonna go down into Judah. Well, what ends up happening is God sends him back. And Elijah spends many years trying to convince the kings of Israel to turn back and follow God. Elijah eventually had to find somebody who could continue to share the message of God with the people of Israel. He found a man by the name of Elisha, who ended up taking his place. Then there were also prophets like Amos, Hosea, and even one named Jonah, who you guys probably know the story of Jonah. Those are just some of the prophets that God sent to Israel to try to convince them to turn from their evil ways and follow him. But they wouldn't listen to them. And because of that, because they followed their evil ways, God said, "Well, I'm going to lift my hand of protection off of you." And he allowed the king of Israel to fall. And I'm not saying trip and fall. What ended up happening was other countries came in and took over and conquered them. And that's the northern kingdom. What about the southern kingdom, Judah? Well, Judah also was making some mistakes, but they did have some good kings. In fact, one of the kings was a little boy that became king when he was only 8 years old. His name was Josiah. Another story that I'd love to share with you sometime. But they also had prophets in Judah that tried to get the people of Judah to always stay faithful to following God. But what ended up happening was they too turned their back on God. And in the next couple of weeks, we're going to discover how God allowed both of those nations to crumble and fall apart. And they got taken into captivity, but then they're going to be brought back. Those are stories that we're going to cover in the next couple of weeks. Thanks, guys, for joining us for Church at Home. I had fun with you. I'll see you again next week. Love you. Bye-bye.